So we had the summer off from South Park, and then we came back basically in the room going, okay, now what the hell do we do? And how are we going to answer all of this stuff? You know, do we leave them divorced? Do we... some of the ideas were that we were going to just keep going like this. Stan lives in an apartment with his mom, and we were just going to have the show go on like that. But, you know, almost immediately we're like, really, we're not going to have Randy around? And Randy's such a great character in the show. And, you know, the more we talked about these big things of, you know, people really liked that we took this big change, you know, this big right turn with the show, and like, how can we keep doing that? And we came up with all these different ideas of how to keep it like this. And
we were going to do a serialized thing.
Yeah, do a serialized thing where he slowly, through the course of the season, tried to get his parents back together. But, like, every time we talked about it, we'd kind of run into a wall and just go, God, you know, it's like we're having to focus on the drama of it all and not be able to just do what's the funniest thing, which is how we do the show. And finally, we're like, you know what? This is South Park. It's a cartoon. People, you know... It's tuned in for that reason. Like it's, you know, we finally were like, you know, we're just kind of stuck. We just don't really have a choice. Things are going to have to just reset, as much as, you know, maybe people will hate that we finally didn't reset. And now we're just going to come back and reset at the end. And we're like, well, maybe we should reset, but just make that really sad. The fact that right. We have to reset.
I remember Vernon was the one that said, oh, what if we play Landslide again and do that? That
yeah,
it was like that kind of key. I really hated the idea of just not doing, like really just crapping out on it. I felt like people had some real emotional connection to that last show, and I want, you know, we want to do something kind of satisfying, but like Trey said, we didn't want to like really go, it's like,
and just make it a sad show
and make it a sad show and like all emotionally complex and shit for, you know, I don't think people would want that. I don't know if we'd be good at that.
And we knew we had these first few scenes, we really liked this, where all the typical South Park stuff was happening, but Stan was just standing there. We really liked all that stuff. We had that for a while. And we had talked about the whole sort of Matrix drinking thing, which was a big, big step to take, have Stan become an alcoholic.
Just because an alcoholic. But then at least he goes and gets to see Jack and Jill, and he really likes it.
Yeah, because he's drunk.
Because basically he's drunk. So he can handle the shittiness of the world if he gets drunk, but then that's not going to work either. I remember the big moment, I remember where I felt like, okay, I think we earned our way back. Was when we came up with the idea of Stan growing up in a real way, because I think it's a real, you know, growing up process to finally say, you know what, my parents are divorced and it's not going back. The world's not going to go back to the way it was. That's the way kids think. It's like, I just want to wake up in the same bed every day and have the same great day and do the thing. And then you get to be a certain age and it's like bad shit starts happening and you don't get to go back. You know, that's a real... really deep thought, and Stan finally gets it, and he gets it in this way that's like, you know what, life isn't like a fucking stupid sitcom where you have to learn some lesson, then everything snaps back, and then at that moment everything snaps back.
Right.
And I feel like that was, I was like, okay, that's cool, that feels like we earned our way back, you know, within what we had kind of set up last season. But it was hard to come. I remember it was hard to make all of this sort of line up.
Well, because we had a lot, we also had all the Asperger stuff going on, which we had talked about for a while too, doing a show about Asperger's, but in the years before, like, that word wasn't used as much, so we were just worried, like, well, if we do a show about Asperger's, everyone's going to think we're making that name up. Mm-hmm. But finally Asperger's had made it enough into the popular culture that we could do a show about how unfortunate of a name that disease is.
We always love that thing, too. If we left the show, people are like, wow, they're really sick of doing, you know, South Park now. Book of Mormon is kind of a big hit, and maybe they're sick of doing South Park. And then we won the Tonys in the off period, right?
Yeah.
And then we just thought it was super funny to then just basically almost answer the question in the title of the show of like, nope, Asperger's.
Yep.
They're just doing that fucking shit. It's still like...
Kramer's got hamburgers in his pants.
That's it. That's what we're doing. So, but I remember being done with the show and feeling like, okay, good. We got out of that
we
one.
We got out of it. Now we can go back to just making South Park.
Yeah.
Let's move on.
So this is had become sort of well known already by this time, sort of Matt and I's dissatisfaction to what George Lucas was doing to Star Wars, which was, you know, it was so disappointing when the new Star Wars came out and he basically just ruined the first three, because obviously us being the generation we were, that was gigantic to us. And to come out and basically say the Force wasn't actually the Force, it was something in your bloodstream, and it wasn't this whole cool Japanese Zen thing that it was supposed to be, and basically just, you know, went and ruined those first three. And so that was bad enough. But then when he said, okay, now I'm going to go back and change the first three, we're like, oh no. Because, you know, these were classic movies to us that we wanted to show to our kids someday.
And but, then Spielberg started doing it.
Yeah. And he literally did that. He put walkie-talkies in the hands of the FBI guys in E.T.
And changed terrorists to hippie.
Yeah. And our sort of our feeling, which is what we say in this episode, is like, you're making art, you know. Hopefully you consider this art. And if that's true, you know, you don't go back and sort of fix your sculpture 10 years later because it has there's a little better...
And by the way, neither of those fixes to E.T. make it better. They make it stupider.
Yeah.
They just make it more, you know, PC. But, yeah.
But I, you know, and it's...
I'm officially, as of now, it's, what is it? It's 2005, right? Yeah. I'm officially over Star Wars. I have to say that. I'm coming out. Because it was so important. I mean, I loved it like everybody else who was, you know, grew up in the 70s. And between the new movies and just how the just how many video games, and how, like, I can't even listen to that score anymore. I'm over it. Yeah. I have to say, I'm over it.
I just actually the other day caught Empire Strikes Back on television, and it made me super sad because I was sitting there watching it and going, this story is so cool to think that, okay, now that guy, that's Darth Vader, and he's actually, to think about sort of the storylines of the first three and how much they screwed it all up, like it could have been so cool if he would have, you know, taken the time, not sort of, I think you could get to a certain age maybe where you just believe that you are as great as everyone tells you and you don't need to fix your story and you don't need an editor and you don't need to go through all the toil on a script that you went through originally, because it's just obvious that those scripts for the first three are just so odd. And that's the only problem with the new shows, is that they're terrible scripts.
Yeah.
And because he was George Lucas, he didn't have anyone say, this is a terrible script, you have to fix it before we'll shoot it. You just had a studio going, go, make it, get it.
Or maybe
the
someone
now.
Did. Maybe someone did and he was like, get out of here.
Right. Maybe.
I mean, who knows, you know, but he needs some people. You need people in your life as somebody who does comedy and, you know, even Star Wars. You need someone to say, nah, that's not very good.
Right.
Someone who's going to be honest with you. And probably George Lucas lives in a big room of liars.
Yeah.
Because everyone's sitting there reading it going, this is great, George.
Yeah.
Good shit.
Because there's no way that anyone with half a brain could have read that script and thought it was good. any one of them. I mean, they're awful. But,
And to retroactively ruin the... It's amazing the same guy made... The first three, I didn't even really like Return of the Jedi, but parts of it are good. But, you know, the first series and then the second series, it's amazing. It doesn't seem like even the same person did it.
We did get a letter from Mr. Spielberg from this episode.
That's right, we did.
And we still to this day do not know if the letter was, if he was pissed off or if he was
Of backhanded. Yeah. It's kind of backhanded. He basically says, I feel finally like I've arrived because I've been, you know, I'm one of the villains in South Park. I love your guys' sharp, witty sense of humor, blah, blah, blah. But it was something kind of crappy about the letter, about the tone of it.
Something that seemed like he was pissed off. But he say that because maybe he wasn't, but.
Yeah, but it seemed like it.
But,
This is the brilliant misunderstanding of Free Hat and a guy named Hat McCullough. Was it Matt? Something
yeah.
McDonough.
But we can't pretend to be this important because we're not. But we did hear from people that worked at Sky. Or
put it out there, even though it's probably not true.
It's probably not true. But we did get the letter from Spielberg, and then we did this. This did come out at a time where Spielberg was. It was in the news that he was going to go back and digitally redo a bunch of shots in Raiders of the Lost Ark and remake that. And that's what we made the show about. Was like, please, Raiders of the Lost Ark is a work of art. Don't fuck with it. And then he didn't. I mean, it's true that he didn't. He didn't do it. And then we heard from people over that studio. Not that he went like, my God, those guys are right. I'm going to do that. But that there was, he did see the episode, which we know because he wrote us a letter. And that he did then just suddenly one day say, I'm not going to do it. So maybe if we had even the smallest bit to do with Raiders of the Lost Ark not getting fucked up, then I'm just as proud of that as wearing dresses to the Academy Awards. But it's probably not true. But we'll believe it.
But whatever.
Whatever, fuck him. All right, next one.
Wait.
So the whole idea for this show was basically just ripping on Russell Crowe. But it came from a very personal experience, actually, where about right around this time, it must have been a little before this when we weren't working on the show, but we had gotten to know Russell Crowe from, I guess, right about the time that we were going around getting some awards for the music in the South Park movie. He was getting an award for best actor in
Insider.
Insider, yeah.
No, one before that. You know, maybe it's Insider or LA Confidential.
But he And so, you know, we'd see him at some of these award shows and we'd drink beers and we're like, ah, that guy's really cool. And, you know, and his buddies from Australia, and they were just normal beer drinking Aussies that seemed cool. And then one day, sort of out of the blue, Russell called and said, hey, I'm finishing my album and I want you guys to come listen to it. And
We wanted us to give notes on the music. And
yeah,
we're
doing the final mix. And, you know, usually that means, if you're, like, doing the final mix, it means you want people to come listen and sort of give feedback, right? And sort of say, oh, well, I would change this or do that. And so, you know, we're like, oh, that's nice. We were flattered, you know. And so we went down to the studio and quickly found out there's already, like, 8 other people there, whatever, that he had called. And then he proceeds to put in sort of not the tape of the music, but a finished CD. He just sort of puts into the CD player and starts playing, sitting, kicking back, and everyone's supposed to sit there, and then the song gets over, and everyone kind of claps. And then the next song starts, and then the next song starts. And Matt and I are kind of looking at each other going, oh, I guess we're just here to sort of listen to Russell's album. We're like, okay, well, okay, all right. And you know, Russell is a very talented actor. He is a very talented actor. And the music was sort of like Bon Jovi meets Hepatitis B, really. And so we sat there, we listened, and then at one point, actually, through about halfway through, he does take me and sits me down in a chair between two speakers, and I'm thinking, and that's usually what you do when you really want someone to say, to give mix notes. And so this one song's playing, and I'm thinking, okay, I'm going to think of something constructive to say, something, you know. And I said, you know what? There's like, if I were you, I would mix out the hand claps in this song. And literally, the place just got quiet, and all these people that were there kind of looked at me like, oh my God, like he said, you know. And I was like, I'm just saying, you know, mix out the hand claps maybe. And Russell took a drag off his cigarette and said, well, maybe I'll mix them off the version I give to you.
And Trey's never gotten that version.
Yeah, and I never got that version. And so then we sort of realized we were supposed to just keep quiet and sit there and listen to Russell's album.
So we did.
And then we did. And then who was it? The director showed up.
No, Robbie Robertson showed up.
Oh, yeah.
Robbie Robertson showed up, and then they started it over.
They started over again, and they're like, we're all going to sit here and listen to it again.
And so we left.
And Matt, and then we left. And then,
we just got a, we,
and so Russell's, oh, honest, you know,
we just got a letter. Nice. Did you know we just got a letter from Russell Crowe?
Really?
He saw Team America, and he loved it.
Oh, that's cool.
He wrote us a nice little letter.
He's always been very nice. He actually,
he's really, really nice to us.
Called me on my birthday and stuff.
And he's really, he's an extremely talented actor.
Yeah.
He's not the best. Sorry,
but unfortunately, that happened, and then it was right around the time we had to come up with an episode.
But also, and so, no, and also, there was a time. There was a period where Russell Crowe was in like a fight in Australia, and then he was a fight in L.A., and then he punched a reporter in London. I mean, it came somewhat from reality. He was like literally within a month or two's time, he had gotten in fights on 3 continents, just bar brawl kind of fights, and that's where this fighting around the world came from.
And he really was doing it.
Yeah. So, and that was that. That was a story mixed with, you know, the boys trying to see the new Terrence and Phillip trailer for Houses of Fire 2.
Yeah.
I mean, I kind of like this. I like the fact that this episode, they basically are watching for the commercials, and the commercials hit.
Right.
I think that's
it's
actually
basically like an episode
clever.
That takes place during the
it's a real
length
time.
Of an episode.
Right. It's a real-time episode. I think it's our only real-time episode.
Yeah.
For all you trivia buffs out there.
Yeah.
But I think that's kind of actually clever. And I love when Tugger, kills himself.
Yeah. Because it's sort of how we felt.
Yeah, and and listening to his music, yeah. And, yeah. Anything else on this episode? I don't remember if there's any. Houses of Fire 2 trailer is really funny.
Yeah, we should have made that movie, but no one would have gone to see it. Yeah. So we made Team America instead, and nobody went to see that.
Yeah, see, Butter's voice is still fucked up, too. Butter's voice doesn't sound good. This has one of the best shots in all of South Park, too, which is where all the blood comes rushing out of the door when Shelley's on her period.
First time we see her period, yeah.
It's the most fucked up shot.
And the door is really symbolic of her vagina. we better move on. Let's move on.
Let's move on.
Hurry.
This was definitely another last-minuter. It was one of those end-of-the-season sort of, all right, we're out of ideas now, what do we do? And we just started talking about Indian casinos. And
my grandmother used to live in Phoenix, and she would go to this Indian casino that was within, you know, like 45 minutes of where she lived in Phoenix. And it was just the most depressing place in the world. And I think that's how we started talking about it.
Yeah.
And then it was just that really, I don't know, kind of simplistic, but that just, it was that role reversal of the, like, the Grapes of Wrath kind of story of the big business coming in and driving people off their land, but done with the now the Indians that are building casinos.
Yeah,
and then it was just like, boom, so many fun scenes to do.
Yeah. That's when ideas like that come, it's great because I can basically go write the whole show in about 8 hours.
Because there's just so much material there. And that idea of like the, you know, that idea of the, you know, of just role reversing it, just every scene was like, oh yeah, we could do that scene and then that scene.
Yeah.
This is, we have a great, I think, great joke. This is good too, the way they laugh. Yeah, and this, we have a chief runs with Premise, yeah. And then his little kid is Premise running thin.
Yeah. And I remember one of the later things, it was sort of a later idea as the show developed. We were like, oh, I know, how about, you know, just like we apparently tried to kill all the Indians with, you know, our diseases. It's like the Indians go out and get a disease. So SARS was a big thing at the time. Everyone was freaking out about SARS. So we gave everyone SARS, and then we were sitting around the writers' meeting going, okay, now what is the white man's cure for SARS? And it was so obvious that it was Sprite and... What is it, like
chicken soup and Sprite, right? Or NyQuil.
DayQuil or something.
Just it's white
so
trash.
It's like that is just the white trash remedy, and it totally works.
Yeah. I mean, it has as much... I mean, the thing is the white trash remedy probably has as much scientific basis as, like, you know, the ancient remedy of the indigenous peoples. It's just kind of whatever works for whatever makes you feel good right then. I especially love this episode.
I really liked it. There was also, this was the episode where there was some kid that won something.
Oh, yeah, there was a kid that, there was a, for Elton John's AIDS Foundation thing.
Right.
His dad had outbid everybody else for the kid to do
a voice on
a voice, so he does a voice in this.
So we're like, oh, what voice are we going to have him do? And then we just decided we'll just have him be that kid. We just made a little cartoon character of him.
Yeah.
We'll never do that again.
Nah. He was all right. I remember his dad was kind of a pain in the butt. The kid was nice, though.
But, I mean, it's pretty amazing when I look at stuff like that because, you know, again, to think that an episode like this we come up with on a Thursday and it's on the air the next Wednesday and it's like just all this new casino stuff and all this stuff that has to get drawn and, you know, it's pretty amazing, actually.
Yeah.
We're fucking rad.
I also think this is one of those episodes that it's got so much material that, you know, when we these are one of those episodes that when we talk to other people in town that make comedy, they're always like, oh, like, not I wish I would have thought of that, but I wish I would have figured out a way to do that, because it's just like there's so much good material in kind of making fun of Indian casinos, but no one will do it. But it's just so obvious. It's so good. I don't know. Luckily, we found it.
Yeah. So that was sort of that season, which I think we can all agree was a really good season. Thank you.
Hold on.
Yeah, thanks. Small-minded idiots pouring their life. So I guess we'll meet you again up in the next one. Out of them like diarrhea from the buffalo. This is our handy car episode. This is what we call our polarizing episode of the run. This is like our Terrence and Phillip, you know, where we think Nathan's a super funny, awesome character, and there's about 10% of the population that agrees with us, of the South Park watching population.
It also sort of was kind of based on this joke that was in the video game Stick of Truth, where Timmy was the fast travel system, and he had this little cart and he would cruise around. So we kind of started talking about that as just the idea of like that's the new Uber in town. And then combining that with Wacky Races. I don't know what Wacky Races. Like, I remember that cartoon, but like,
it was another one of those, like, for us, for almost all of us and everyone we talk to, it's like you remember the Hanna-Barbera cartoons as being shitty. Like, even when you were 5 and 6, you knew they were shitty. You knew that the Warner Brothers stuff was really awesome and that, you know, there's this crap on Saturday morning on that was Hanna-Barbera stuff. And boy, looking at the Wacky Races stuff, it's just so shitty. We had to look
so
at a bunch
much
of
fucking, so much fucking bread and so little butter. Yeah. Just a little bit of butter on a lot of bread. That's what.
Speaking of which, this episode was actually, you know, there was only one other. Well, Nathan first made an appearance in Up the Down Steroid, where he sold steroids to Jimmy. And he was just one of those characters that just, you know, he had a few lines in that, and we just always really liked him. And then we did the whole summer camp show where they hated Jimmy and they were trying to get rid of him. So when we came up with Timmy doing a handy car service, we thought, oh, and then we'll have this little runner with Nathan and Mimsy, and then Nathan and Mimsy became the big, not just a runner, but basically the entire show, which we liked.
Which we like, and 10 other people in the world like. So if you guys are out there, This one's for you.
Jimmy has raised $16. But yeah, with Handy Car, I mean with we definitely use we use Uber a lot here at the show.
I use Uber. I use Uber in different cities.
But we were talking about that whole thing which you know was the real discussion of the show was how so many cabbies were getting so pissed off at Uber, and then we'd get in a cab and it sucked so bad. It's like, well, make it not suck.
And yeah, I go back in New York. I ride Ubers and I ride cabs, and it's consistently better to ride an Uber.
Yeah,
and it just is. So, and I feel like the whole thing is going to change in just a few years, where we're all just going to be in computerized Uber cars.
Yep.
And it's like the argument's going to be over.
It's just our laptops will be in the cars. We won't even be in them.
Yeah, just send your laptops.
We'll be at home in bed.
Just send your laptops around in Ubers.
All right,
let's move on.
So the first thing in part three was I wanted to figure out a different way to... I didn't want to just do another previously on, because that's what it always is. And so we kind of struggled to come up with this way that we realized we could use something from the second Lord of the Rings, where the guy's sitting there.
Yep.
Basically, this shot's from that movie.
He's kind of saying what happens. Yeah. Here's the setup for where we are, resetting the table for all this stuff.
And it was challenging. I mean, coming up with all... We had to just keep coming up with imaginary characters and trying to run the gamut, you know, not making them all animated characters, and try to make some of them, you know, different countries and different live-action shows or whatever it was. So it was actually, we had to, and you know, dolls and stuff like that, we just had to keep trying to come up with them. I like that little smurf in the back.
Yeah. It's as much storyland, too, as imagination land.
Yeah.
Because really the central point of the whole kind of thing comes around to the power of story and how, you know, that we always like the idea that Jesus is just as important as Luke Skywalker, as just as important as a smurf.
Yeah.
And, you know, they all kind of live here.
And as to the same, you know, when people ask if I believe in God and Jesus, I say yes, and I believe in Luke Skywalker, and I believe in Santa Claus, and that this was the show that was really about that, because that's sort of the point, is it's like those things are super big and important, and they all live together and fight evil.
And I believe in Al Gore.
That's probably good. And we got to have Man Bear Pig back, which was nice too, and actually see Man Bear Pig.
I think people were hankering for Man Bear Pig.
Everyone loves Man Bear Pig.
Fan favorite. That's probably good for Imagination Land.
Yes,
we've talked
did it.
So much about that.
So the whole idea for this show came about from, at the writer's retreat, we came up with the idea of like, yeah, cars can be bad because they cause smog, but hybrid cars cause smog, and that's way worse. And it really was true, because, you know, especially here in L.A., it's like, I mean, they're really... Still is, but there was just this time where it was like people that drove hybrid cars just went around, you know. And most people in L.A. drive hybrid cars, and then they go and get private jets to go wherever they need to go and burn more fuel than the average person in an SUV will in a year. But then they drive around in their hybrid going, yeah, I'm doing something for the... And they do talk with their eyes closed.
We were at a dinner with some really high... Like, one of the... Like, we don't go to these dinners very often. It's like one of the only dinners we've gone to where it's like really high-level Hollywood people, like high-level execs, studio heads and stuff at this dinner. Literally everyone at the table, except for us, flew in private jets almost exclusively. Like, these people hadn't flown commercial in years. And all of them, to a person, had a hybrid and were congratulating themselves about, like, having this hybrid. I'm first on the list to get the new Ford hybrid. That's great. Good
and
for you.
And a woman at the dinner actually said, yeah, well, it's important for us to set an example.
Yeah, because then we started bringing up the private jet thing. Well, isn't that weird that you fly a G5 and then you also have a hybrid? Like, what the fuck is that? And they're like, well, it's up to people like us, you know, to set an example for the little people.
And then
they were so fucking smug about it. It was unbelievable. And the other thing that's interesting is that in researching this episode, we found out that part of the reasons why I think it was a Honda hybrid, where the hybrids where they try to make it look like the regular version of the car don't sell as well as like the Prius or something that looks different, in the way that people who have hybrids really want other people to know that it's a hybrid.
Yeah.
So that's why they all have to look different. People don't want, like, well, if I just buy that car, no one's going to know I bought a hybrid and I'm awesome. And so they don't sell as well.
But
it's really interesting.
It also came about because I bought my mom one of those Honda hybrids. And just because, you know, it's my mom, it doesn't have to pay as much for gas. That makes sense for her. So I bought her a hybrid, and she told me that, and it still happens, she said that the first day she was driving around in that car,
people were pulling up next to her and giving her a thumbs up and going, good for you, in their hybrids. And I was like, you got to be fucking kidding me. And she's like, no, that's what they do. And so, you know, it's like, yeah, good for you, you know, her son, I bought her that, and I own two SUVs, you know, whatever. That, it's just, it doesn't need, but then that's why we put that in this show.
It's like the whole idea of, like, environmental stuff and hybrids or whatever is fair trade coffee and stuff is so much about people feeling good about themselves buying it. It's like, well, now I feel a lot better about buying this thing because this is actually blah, 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 which I guess is all right. I mean, if it does good, but it's just
fine. As long as you're not saying it with your eyes closed.
Yeah, and as long as you're not a fucking dick about it.
Because it really, that's what
brought us to the eyes closed thing is when someone says something with their eyes closed and goes, well, you know, I just like to do something good for the earth with their eyes closed, you know, something's fucking wrong.
Yeah. And that basically is 90% of San Francisco. I mean, when we were coming up with, you know, smug and the whole idea of what would be the smuggiest city in the country, there was no doubt what it would be San Francisco, because they really believe they know what's best and that everyone else is just kind of retarded. And people right now in San Francisco are sitting there listening to this going, but we do, with their eyes closed, saying, no, we don't think we're better. We just think, you know, we lead the way a little bit. And you're saying it with your eyes closed, and fuck you.
And then, remember, this was right, and then we would work the George Clooney speech in this. George Clooney at the Oscars said something like, well, we're the most progressive people. We're always ahead of the curve anyway. Like, we gave this black actor the, I think, best. I don't actually remember the particular, but he said something. It was very... like, get up in front of Hollywood and say, but we're pretty awesome here in Hollywood. It was the smuggiest thing we'd ever heard in our life. It was so self-congratulatory. He just had a huge hand patting himself on Hollywood on the back. And so we made that into, like, the big thing that's going to create the perfect storm of smug. A perfect smug storm. The other thing that's funny about this episode is when Ike is tripping balls.
That was
pretty he's tripping balls right now.
We just got a little kid to say, I'm totally tripping balls.
And it's so funny the way he says it. It sounds like he's tripping balls.
It sounds like he's tripping balls. All right, let's move on.
Hey, Eric, where's Kyle? Who?
I mean, look, guys, I know it was just the Dolphins.
So after we had done Book of Mormon, which we did with our friend Bobby Lopez, it was really fun working with Bobby, and he's a really funny guy. So at some point during that whole thing, we're like, you know, you should come one week and do an episode of South Park with us and just, you know, be in the room and kick around ideas. We really didn't, when he arrived on Thursday, we got in the room and we kicked around a whole, it was also Halloween time. So we're like, well, we could just do a Halloween show. We didn't necessarily think we were going to do anything about Broadway or musicals until we kind of had this idea that maybe, you know, what if we, like, blatantly do the thing that's, like, trying to make Broadway cool for dudes and that it's all about bros and everything. And, you know, it's always scary when you go into a show like this and you've got to write a bunch of songs, because even though they're short, it's still a bunch of songs you got to write. So,
and then I remember you wrote that song for the middle with the Tim Tebow song.
Yeah, and that's what I'm most proud of, because
Tim Tebow song.
We actually, if you look at when this aired, it was actually October 26th of 2011, which was before Tebow Mania started at all. It was the first week he started playing, and I wrote all these Tim Tebow songs, just sort of predicting all that, and then Tebow Mania really happened.
I think you started Tim Tebow Mania.
I think I did. But, we wrote the songs.
Then Bro Down and Broadway, that's kind of when... The Bro Down is the best part of the show, where they, the Stephen Sondheim and stuff, and they come in the Hooters and do the Bro Down. It's like, bro, like that's really like funniest.
But I remember I kept putting it off, and like we'd written a couple of the songs for like the Wicked parodies, but there were all these other songs like the montage when Randy's in New York, and then we needed other songs for Randy's musical and everything. And Bobby kept saying, like, when are we going to write those? And I'm like, oh, we'll worry about that later, because we were just trying to figure out the story. And then it got to be like Tuesday, and Bobby's like, when are we going to write those songs? And I was like, I guess we should write those now. And we were just like frantically writing songs on Tuesday. And we got it all done.
Yeah. I wish Bobby could just move to L.A. and just work on South Park all the time. It'd be great. We'd have fun working with him. But unfortunately, he has a life and a big career and everything. But he's like, that was such a cool thing to have him come out. Maybe we can get him to do it again.
Yeah, probably.
We don't have to do a musical episode.
No,
do
we're gonna.
You know? All right, let's move on. That's Blowjobs and
me. Previously on Battlestar Galactica.
See, that's actually another. That's another great show. I mean, the Battlestar Galactica and their ability to kind of have something original in each week, so it's sort of not always about the same thing, and yet have these through lines that kind of keep you keep you watching.
It's all about keeping balls up in the air.
Yeah.
And they're really, really good at
it. And that literally happens here, since it's all about Cartman trying to get Kyle to suck his balls.
Wow.
He's trying to keep those balls in the air.
Wait a second.
It was actually originally the first episode that aired, the evil characters were supposed to break through, and sort of all hell breaks loose with those characters, and then that's where we're going to leave it. And then it got to be Tuesday night, the day before the show went on the air, and it was about 3 in the morning when Frank came into me, the producer, and said, we're not going to make, there's no way, we're like still 100 shots out. We're going to easily be here till 10 a.m., and even then, these shots just, they're not going to make it. We're not going to make air. So I had to suddenly reimagine, okay, what do we go out on? And so all the part in the first one that ended with the guy going, they are coming, and it just ending on that note, I was actually really bummed out about it, because I thought it was just really, I was like, oh, that's, people are going to be bummed out of it, it ends that way. But it actually ended up kind of working, because everyone was like, oh, I can't wait to see what comes out of it.
Yeah, everyone was like, I wonder what's going to come out beyond the wall.
And they were like, oh, we better make this satisfying. So it's basically this shot right here that was going to be in the first episode, and I'm glad we didn't now, because it wouldn't have looked nearly that good. It was like, it used to be like 15 characters coming out.
Kind of really spend a little more time on it and make it a little bit better. And this stuff too. This was going to happen at the end of the left.
Yeah, that's right. That all was supposed to happen. But now we were able to put all this into part two, and so that made that a little easier.
It made it a little better. What else happens in part two?
Part two is the big imagination doorway.
Yeah.
And we had that idea for a long time.
Yeah, it's basically Stargate. We just basically, and then that's why Kurt Russell's in it.
Yeah.
Because we just said, well, we just know.
Everyone knows we're doing Stargate. We might as well just put Kurt Russell in
it.
I mean, and the big thing, too, was obviously this. The thing we were happy about was that we really loved the episode we did, Woodland Critter Christmas. And the thing is, we really wanted to see those characters again, but we're like, yeah, but, you know, technically you can't, because in that episode, the Woodland Critter Christmas were made up by Cartman. It was just a book that he wrote. And so, really, you couldn't bring them back because they're imaginary. And so now we realize, wait a minute, we've got imaginary characters now. We can have the critters.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as we're like, oh, let's bring the critters back, then we knew, okay, everything. We've at least got another part here. We can make this three parts now.
As soon as the critters were in it, everything kind of came together.
And that's why it was pretty funny, because what happened when the first episode aired, Comedy Central put in an ad that said, tune into the thrilling conclusion next week. And then everyone saw this episode and saw, wait, no, it's not the, it's gonna, and everyone thought Comedy Central messed up, but actually we were the ones who told them it was only going to be a two-parter. And then we started making this episode, and a lot of fun stuff was happening, and stuff we just wanted to keep it going, and we liked where it was going, we liked how it ended, so we're like, no, let's go and tune in for three parts. So it was a big it was a big challenge. It was a big 3 weeks, because there's obviously a lot of stuff going on, but it was fun.
Yeah, it was cool that it came in the middle of the season, too.
Yeah.
We thought about it. It was better, I think, because it broke up the season.
Yeah. All right, let's look at part three. I wonder what happens in that. Time to pay up, so then begins Imagination Land, and we've actually, we did commentary on almost this entire, all three parts we already did for Imagination Land DVD, so we'll sort of just hit the highlights here.
We might repeat stuff, or we may totally contradict what we say in that one, too. We may say totally different stuff.
I just remember
that, lying anyway.
I remember kind of emotionally being at the place where we had done the Tourette's, where Cartman had, you know, it was just all about Cartman swearing, and then we did more crap, which was about a giant shit, and then, so it started becoming this thing, we were starting to, you know, hear that people were going, oh, you guys are just doing scatological humor now, you know, this is it, you guys, and so we're like, we felt kind of like, yeah, I guess those were two big kind of scatological shows in a row, and it's like, it's time to bring out the big guns and do something a lot more, a bigger sort of satire and parody. And so we had had this idea to do terrorist bombing our imaginations. We'd had that idea for a long time.
Yeah.
And we just didn't quite know how to do it, how to pull it off. And it also sounded like a big enough idea that we're like, oh, maybe it could be the next movie if we ever wanted to do a movie again. So we kind of always kept it in our back pocket. And then I remember this, actually, we sat down and said, let's just do the Imagination Land show and we'll just do it as one episode. And so we were actually going to do this whole thing.
Yeah.
We started on a Thursday of that week. We just started Thursday and Friday doing scenes and being like, okay, it's going to be one episode. They're going to go. Like, all this stuff that happens over three episodes was going to happen in one. It would have been horrible because nothing would have gotten the time it needed. And
been terrible.
So as it went, you know, it got to be Saturday, Sunday. We're like, well, you know what? This is gonna be a two-parter. That's cool. Two-parter. And then really by the time
it's still, we talked about even in the second week of, we talked about it. Could still be a two-parter.
Right.
And then we decided to make it three.
Yeah.
So we didn't really know.
Yeah, we didn't really know. But
I love the idea that it's just a leprechaun that goes into Imagination Land. I really like that. Because we tried to think of something more creative than a leprechaun, yeah, but I just like that it's a leprechaun. I think it's something less derivative and more funny. Just like, nope, a leprechaun.
And it is, it turned out cool. I mean, after making the three episodes, on the one hand, we were kind of like, you know, we probably could have taken more time with it and made it into a movie and made things bigger and all that. But on the other hand, writing-wise, I had a really good time doing this because I think some of the best writing to come out of Hollywood these days is the drama TV shows, you know, like the 24s and Lost and things like that, that are the big, can you leave things kind of hanging and where will you do it, since you have to continue next week. And so it was kind of a fun challenge to kind of, especially episode two was the big challenge, to keep all the balls in the air but make it satisfying, have enough twists. And so it was actually, I'm glad we did this as a three-parter.
Yeah, I'm glad now, because now we can move on to episode two, and talk more about it. That's why I'm glad we did it as a TV show.
Dude, what are we going to do for New Year's Eve? It has to be awesome.
I know. It's probably going to be the
So this was the episode we did for the new millennium. It was from 1999 to 2000 New Year's. And I remember Comedy Central just wanted a millennium show because it was something everybody was doing. Everyone had the millennium episode of this and that and the other. And so really our season was over. It ended with that Christmas special. But then I don't remember. Did we come back in January and make this, or did
no?
Did
I think we
have
I think we made it before we left.
That's weird that we actually did a show ahead of time.
Yeah, I think we left. But everyone, it was like no one cared because we're so sure Y2K was going to hit, and then you know all the computers were going to stop, and it was going to be World War III. So we didn't care.
But I remember because on New Year's Eve I was in Times Square.
Yep.
Where were you?
In Colorado. I was in Steamboat Springs.
Oh.
Snowboarding. I thought that would be the perfect place to hang out for the millennium.
Perfect place to die.
Perfect place for World War III to be Steamboat Springs, Colorado. Dude,
Carmen can't. But yeah, this is where Carmen gets his period. I'm gonna go see if I'm bleeding out my ass. And
this is also episode where we see God.
Yeah, this is the first time we, you know, we knew that Jesus was looked like Jesus and, you know, talked like Jesus, but we had to have. I remember we talked a long time. What should God look like? Should he be the sort of grandfather figure we always see, or a
Vishnu kind of thing, or like?
And then we ended up making it a sort of like a midget hippopotamus lizard thing,
cat hippopotamus thing.
Yeah, which is kind of like, why not?
Yeah,
I mean,
every religion has their own version of God, and none of them really makes sense.
Because you would hope that God would be that cool, that, like, if he can take any form, that he'd do something that would just fuck with your head really bad, you know, and do, like, midget hippopotamus or something.
You know, sweet too, then he shows up in Las Vegas, right?
Yeah.
Look at that shot with those TV cameras. God damn those TV cameras. If you look at the TV cameras in that shot, they're, like, from 1930.
That's probably the and we just caught that about 4 months ago when we were doing the show.
The fuck are those TV cameras?
We still had these TV cameras, and we never,
The fuck are those?
And so, yeah, this is Jesus, sort of the same thing as Groundhog's Day, basically.
Yeah. Why did Jesus pick Las Vegas to come back to?
Because he has to put on a huge show.
Oh, that's right.
He feels like people don't care anymore, and so now he's got to put on a huge show. So he gets, you know, what's his name? The old rock star, Rod Stewart.
Oh, Rod Stewart, that's right.
He gets Rod Stewart to come out, and he poops his pants.
Oh, that's right. Poops his pants.
And I can't remember. I mean, I remember we had to do this episode, and then I guess we had to do it. It was really weird the way the season worked out this time. We sort of owed shows or something like that.
I don't remember at all.
Yeah. What happens at the
millennium?
The season should have just ended with the Christmas show.
And there's that address. The address on the show of Jesus is 80122, which I think is the zip code in Colorado, probably where you live.
No, mine's 80465.
Mine was 80120. It's probably where Eric's is. Some smarty. Has a little trivia for you.
But what I'm really interested in is there's still one show left in this run, and I don't know what it possibly could be, because we basically did all this. We did the Christmas show. We did a New Year's show.
And that should have been the end.
And yet they're saying there's one more show left in this DVD season. And
I don't know
I'm
about
so
you, but
curious
I can't
to see
wait
what
to
it
find
is.
Out.
I think we should just move right on to it.
Hello? Dude, did you get your period yet?
So then we entered into this run of shows that we did basically in the summer, sort of like June, July-ish. And the thing I remember about this season was
Bill Curtis.
It was just sort of like, before every run of shows, whether it's four episodes or now they're longer, seven and eight, but we have what we call a writer's retreat, where we like get, you know, our basically our friends together, and we just go somewhere in the country and hang out and come up with just sort of broad stroke ideas for shows and sort of
and
like,
drink.
Let's do a show about this and let's do a show about that. But really, it's just an excuse to go and party on other people's money. But I remember that the retreat for this run of shows, we actually got on a cruise that went to Ensenada, Mexico. And we really thought, like, that'll be sweet because we'll be kind of like trapped on a boat and we'll get like a lot of work done.
Instead, we were just trapped on a boat.
And we were just trapped on, and just the scummiest, like, just, you know, pools and whirlpools filled with pee. Just like, it was just the biggest, like, frat party, like, horrible thing down to, you know, the biggest shithole in the world, Ensenada, Mexico.
It was a booze cruise.
I don't know what the hell we were thinking, but,
at least the food was terrible.
Yeah.
The drinks were totally shitty. People would come up to us on the boat and be like, hey, are you Matt and Trey from South Park? And we're like, yeah, we are. And they're like, what the fuck are you doing on this cheap-ass cruise?
Because, yeah, it was like a fucking $300 cruise, too.
Can't you guys afford something better? We're like, yeah, like, why are we on this cheap-ass cruise?
And it was only because Ensenada was the only place we could go that was, like, short enough. Otherwise, we'd be gone for, you know, 10 or 12 days.
The other thing I remember about this episode is a lot of people, we were concerned, and I think it was a just concern. It seems like the concept of NAMBLA, the North American Man Boy Love Association, that we must have made that up.
Yeah.
And we always come, whenever you tackle something that's just so extreme and weird like NAMBLA, you run into that problem where this episode's funny if you know NAMBLA is real, and if you think we made up NAMBLA, it's not as funny. But I think most people know about NAMBLA. But I remember that was a big concern going into this episode, is really trying to make people know, like, sometimes we feel like doing that in an episode, we feel like just saying to people, no joke, stop the show, this is real. This really exists. Now watch the show again. Of course, you can't do that. So, but NAMBLA is one of those things.
But this was also basically in the soap opera world of South Park. I remember. I think this was why Garrison gets arrested in this show for being the guy that Cartman's trying to meet later on.
Yeah.
And from being arrested, he gets fired from being a teacher, which much later in the next season will come into play because Garrison's out and the new teacher's brought in.
Is that right? Yeah. Is this where it starts?
And Garrison's off in the woods somewhere, like, being a hermit.
I like the end of this episode, too. We did a French farce, kind of stupid.
Yeah, but what's the song from some French dude? What was that guy's name? Whatever.
I can't remember.
Jean-Francois, whatever. Who cares? See, it's starting to get boring. So I think we'll quit there and we'll move on to the next episode.
Move on to the next commentary mini.
Stupid party.
Come on, Stan. You're going to have a great time.
So this was episode 2 of the trilogy, which we call the Meteor Shower Trilogy. And while Cartman is being babysitted by Shelley in the previous episode, a lot of people in town, including his mother, are driving to the Meteor Shower party at Mr. Mackey's house. And that's where now this episode, which is sort of the Stan-featured episode, Stan's got to go to the party and hang out with the sort of nerdy kids at the party.
In the basement, because all the parents are upstairs getting drunk.
Yeah.
Which is exactly what I will do when I have kids, is I'll go to my friends and I will party and get all fucked up and I will lock my kids in the basement with some stale pretzels.
Absolutely locked. And this is the episode that is, in a lot of ways, the birth of Butters, the character Butters, because although we've seen him before and I think we've heard a line or two from him before, this is really where we needed to make him into a character. And it's funny because his voice is a little different, just like all the characters, his voice is a little different starting here because Matt's just sort of figuring it out.
Now, I remember because we came up with this because Mr. Butters is what we call our animation director, Eric Stow. And on the movie, when we were working on the movie, just locked in the movie office for late hours, we started making fun of him because he is right here. That's what he sounds like when he talks. He just is a little wuss. And so we started making fun of his voice, and then out of that was like, hey, maybe we should just attach that to Butters and make a real character out of that.
Yeah.
So it really came out of making fun of Eric.
And then Butters over the years has evolved and evolved into probably definitely one of my top three favorite characters. And he became, and actually he then later became Professor Chaos, the bringer of all destruction and doom, and that little kid next to him, Dougie, became his partner in evil, General Disarray.
Yes.
And he doesn't really, he's in this episode, General Disarray, that little Dougie kid, is in this episode, and then not again until that.
For like 3 years.
Yeah, he disappeared for 3 years. Great party, Mr. Mack. Because we really thought our classic nerdy character we had was Pip, but then really after this episode, we realized Butters was
Butters is a better character.
Oh, I'll pass. I don't.
And then the other story, and this is where Stan's dad and Kyle's dad have a little homosexual experience.
But they just watch each other jack off, and so it arises. Does watching a friend jack off make you gay? Which we've learned, no, it certainly doesn't.
Somebody told us that.
So we've been told it's fine.
And then this episode also, it ends with a homage to our brothers in the Branch Davidians who were slaughtered by the horrible
fallen
U.S. government.
Brothers in Waco.
Were slaughtered by the U.S. government in the Waco disaster.
Yeah, there was like some HBO documentary right around this time that came out about Waco, and we saw it and we're like, wow, boy, they really, really fucked that up. And
yeah.
So we did our own version of what happened. Really, it's just sort of exactly what happened in Waco at the end of this. And
pretty much, including the Cher. Didn't they play Cher here?
Yeah, they play Cher to try to drive people out, and they actually did that in Waco.
Yeah, well, they do that all the time. They did that with like Noriega, and apparently they're doing that in Iraq now too. Using heavy metal.
I'd have shot myself. There's no question about it.
But I don't think they use Cher, do they? I don't know.
And then we do this Cher parody at the end of this show, and that's Pam Brady again doing the voice of Cher.
Oh, Mr. Mackey, you nuts.
Hell, we should get
And
in.
So, just like in the other one, you see at the end of this, I don't remember what it is again. I think it's something to do with Skyler being chased by cats or something, but it's at the end of this episode that references the episode before this. And then this hurls us, of course, into the third episode of the
and
trilogy.
Chilling conclusion.
Which is the grand finale of it all, okay, Jubilee, which we'll go on to now.
On Commentary Mini.
You know what our mission is, little first grade kid?
We're here live at the Cozy 102.1.
So we had all had a big, nice break off from the movie and went our separate ways and got our first break in a long time and... We had to come back and start working on a new show, which was going to be the first episode of the next season was going to be Halloween. And so I remember this episode being one of the most difficult we ever did because I think it was just because we were gone for a while and on our heads were in a different place. And then it just took forever to try to get back into the groove of things.
We were still on vacation.
Yeah. But I love this episode, actually, because this is where we first really tried a different style of animation. We tried to do a Hanna-Barbera looking Scooby-Doo style of animation and see if we could do it, you know, in our same program and do all the same things we do South Park with, but make it look like Hanna-Barbera. And I think they did a great job with all the corn guys just suddenly look like Hanna-Barbera in our world. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, and this is the corn approached, or through, you know, some people work for us and through corn's management company. They kind of approached us because their new album was coming out and they said, hey, we'd love to have our, you know, you can premiere our first single on South Park, and we'd never really into that kind of like too cheesy of a promotion thing. But then we started thinking about how great it would be to just do an entire episode with them, you know, and make them like this kind of like,
well, because to do like the Harlem
mystery.
When the Harlem Globetrotters would come on Scooby Doo,
exactly.
That was the whole idea, was do that with Korn.
So in this, do them in this, you know, recast Korn in this totally like Scooby Doo kind of thing.
Super cheesy role.
Yeah.
And I remember they were all super cool and they were into it and they all did a good job. And then except for that dude,
The bass player was kind of bummed out.
He was bummed out because we made him Velma. And like they did a version of him where he like had glasses and he does have glasses.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
like
yeah.
They did a version where they really made him look kind of feminine and like Velma and really fat. And he's like, I'm not fat and I don't wear glasses. And he was all pissed off and everything. But the other guys laughed at him enough that they made him stick with it.
Yeah, and I think they did a great job. Their voices and stuff, you know, I think they did a really good job getting into it.
And of course, there's nothing better than Niblet.
Yeah, Niblet, the best character that's been in 7 seconds of South Park. Like, the best 7-second character in all of
He's
South
another
Park.
Tally. We need sort of a Moses Tally Niblet special.
Yeah.
That's what we got to do next.
Because Niblet just is so underutilized in South Park. It's a great...
And I just love spooky pirate ghosts. They always work.
And the argument of whether it was pirate ghosts or ghost pirates was really an argument that we had in the writer's room.
Yeah,
about
Kyle,
which was
Kyle
better.
McCullough, one of the writers, yeah. Was like, they're not pirate ghosts, they're ghost pirates. And they actually, and Matt argued with them because Kyle and Matt always argue in things. And they actually sat there and argued about whether it was a pirate ghost or a ghost pirate. And then, of course, that just went into the show.
Because it matters, because if there were pirates that died, then they were ghost pirates. And if they were ghosts first, just people that died and then became pirates, then they'd be pirate ghosts. And so we just put that argument in the show because it is so retarded.
So, yeah, so we're super proud of that episode, and that's why we're not going to talk a whole much more about it. We're
yeah, just let you watch it and enjoy it.
Move on to the next thing.
And commentary mini. With my little eyes, something that begins
with the letter T. This is how to eat with your butt. And one of the cool things about this was the first time we basically said, well, let's see the boys without their hats and what their hair looks like. We might have seen what some of the, I know we probably saw what Cartman's hair looks like before this, but I know we hadn't seen Kyle's because I remember doing this scene. And it was the first time we decided that Kyle had a big red Jufro, big ginger kid Jufro.
And why he'd be so bummed to take off his hat.
Yeah.
So pictures.
But this came from some of South Park stuff comes from little things I drew in high school, and I used to always draw a little comic strip with two people with butt heads that had to eat but they had asses for heads, and then they and it was basically just this thing that was, for years we were like, no, that's too juvenile, that we can never make that into a show. And then finally, in this run of shows, we were like, well, fuck it, let's do it.
Yeah, we're juvenile enough. I remember we had a really hard time trying to figure out Kenny, how the logistics of him getting his butt there, how his hands and legs worked. And it kind of does make sense, but I remember that took a long time to figure out, okay, where's his hand go if that's his butt?
This is also where Cartman loses his sense of humor, because he basically sees the two people with giant ass heads, and he thinks it's basically the funniest thing he ever saw, and he can't laugh at anything.
Nothing else is funny after that.
I think this is one of the first times that we brought Jimmy back.
Yeah.
Because I remember it was just sort of, we were stoked to like, oh, let's have him bring that stand-up comic kid. And he sits there and does the knock-knock jokes with Jimmy. It was sort of the first time that we were like, you know, Jimmy might have some staying power in the show. Maybe we should keep bringing him back.
Jimmy might have legs.
And how does this end up? This ends up like Ben Affleck is the ass baby or something?
Yeah, Ben Affleck is looking for their son, their long lost son, the Thompson.
Yeah.
And they come in, and then finally it's Ben Affleck, who looks just, I think, like Ben Affleck, but that was supposed to be the joke, that he has a butt.
So
a head,
immature. So immature.
God.
I apologize for this episode.
It's just so stupid.
But I do like it a lot. This is also one of the first times that we really started defining the relationship of Butters with his parents. The fact that they got really pissed off that he made a face when he really didn't try to make a face at all.
And he just smiled, really.
I know there's that part where the mom is yelling at him, saying, get that look off your face. And he's like, Mom, I'm not making a face.
Butters' parents are just insane.
Yeah.
Especially his mother.
Well, they did try to murder him.
Yeah. They're actually kind of bad parents.
Yeah. But that's enough about this episode.
Let's go to the next commentary mini. Sweetest thing I've ever done.
Well, this episode, this was a real painful episode to do because we were trying to...
So we made it two.
Yes, we made it two parts to make it super hard. A lot of it was we had really been sort of put into the group of atheists. Just I think people just assumed we were atheists.
No, it was that Nightline thing.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
We did an interview for Nightline, and we are totally surprised by this question the interviewer asks, where he says, so you guys are atheists because you've made fun of religion a lot on the show. And we were like, no, we're not atheists. Like, what? We're not atheists. And we kind of briefly stated our feelings about that. And then we get this call from Penn, our friend Penn from Penn Jillette from Penn and Teller. And
we got an email.
Oh, we got an email saying that he was devastated. He was heartbroken to find out that we weren't atheists. And if you know Penn, he was serious. He really was heartbroken to find out that we didn't consider ourselves atheists. And that kind of sent us on this whole trip where, you know, we started reading about atheism and kind of learning about it and decided to do this very painful to produce two episode statement, right? Kind of.
Well, because God, Richard Dawkins' book, The God Delusion, had just come out too, and so
and Sam Harris's End of Faith.
Yeah, and so I fought through Dawkins' book, and it was just like, wow. It just, Dawkins' book to me sounded exactly like that kid when you were like in high school, that like 15-year-old that was running around going, don't be stupid, God, you know. And it was just like, yeah, we know. And like, you know, I didn't grow up in a big religious household, but like, you know, it was also, it's like there's also like the kids when you're in like first grade, and then there's that one first grader going around telling all the kindergartners, there's no Santa Claus, you know, stupid. How do you think Santa Claus could go around the world and get in everyone's chimney in one night? Does that make any sense? And you're like, dude, fucking chill out.
We know.
We're having fun believing in Santa Claus. Fucking relax. But
But anyway, we want, you know, it was just, we probably should have let it percolate a little bit. Instead, we just dove right into, like, let's do an atheism show. And, you know, a lot of times we kind of figure out what our take is on something as we're doing the show and what our opinion is on something. And then what always ends up happening is we take all that shit out of the show and just put funny stuff in, you know, yeah, as much as we can, because we realize we'll do it a bunch and then we realize, okay, we're just getting preachy here. And not even preachy, because we're not trying to preach our opinion, because usually we don't know what it is. But it's just like, it's getting too talky, it's getting too thinky, and let's just add, you know, retarded fish frog into the whole thing.
What we wanted to make fun of was how bitchy, like how even if you can read parts of like Richard Dawkins' book or Sam Harris's book and agree with them, you're just like, the tone of it is so bitchy and whiny that you just are like, ugh. Like, but then as we started doing the episode, I think we got into these existence of God arguments. And I was like, how the fuck do you make that funny? You just don't. Right. So then we decided to put otters and a wee, and then the wee was coming out.
Because, so that really honestly, was and deal. that really did kind of get to the core of it all, because here on one side is like, you know, you need to read Dawkins' book, and I'm reading Dawkins' book, and I'm, you know, having interactions with Penn and emails saying, and him saying, well, what do you think about this? You know, and really getting down into this whole thing, because, you know, and all I had said on the Nightline thing, by the way, was like, yeah, I believe in a God, but it would take me hours to explain what I mean by that, which I think a lot of people can understand. But, and I'm going through all that and thinking, but that was like 5% of my day. 95% of my day was like, Wii is coming out in a week, and I'm freaking out, because I've been waiting for the Wii for like 5 months. And at the end of the day, that's what I was really concerned about, which really does go to the heart of my religion. It's basically like... Okay, you can argue and you can scream and you can get upset at these people and they can get upset at them, but the fucking Wii's coming out in a week, and it's going to have Zelda with it, and that's pretty amazing. So that was really, you know, that was when we were like, let's do an atheism show, but let's really make it all about the Wii.
Yeah.
And we got free Wii's coming. Thank you very much.
We got free Wii's.
I will say, Nintendo people came.
I wish Penn would write a book about atheism, because talking to him about atheism was much better and cooler, and I learned more than reading any of the books that have been out recently.
Yeah.
He actually does a better job explaining it in his position. He's not a bitchy whiner about it. Let's go to the second part and talk more about atheism.
You know how in space movies they put astronauts in suspender animation so that their trip seems really short, right?
Really what had happened is that we, you know, just through the plot of the story of the last one, we had sent Cartman to the future. So we're like, dude, we just sent Cartman to the future at like the end of a show. Like, how can we just end that? And we were like, we have to do a part two. And in a way, we were super bummed, because that means we have to do two parts of talking about atheism, which we were just had realized we didn't want to really talk about anymore. And so, but we also, I don't know why, but we just kept saying otters riding ostriches. Ostriches should be riding ostriches in the future. And that's really all we had going.
That's about all we had, yeah. And we had this Buck Rogers beginning, which is pretty great.
I used to love Buck Rogers. Me and my dad would watch Buck Rogers every week.
I like this little costume that Cartman's in when what's the chick's name? Is in there?
Wilma. yeah, what was her name? Wilma something.
What the heck? Aaron?
Aaron Gray was
Aaron
the
Gray.
Actress.
There, that one. That shot. That's the face. Like, all this shit's happened. Play chess with otters.
Yeah, I mean, we were stoked on that idea. We're like, let's go to the future and then just say that just tons of stuff has happened and you missed it all. And that's why we called this like Go God Go part, what, 12 or 13, something like that?
Yeah, part 12.
But actually, this opening scene I think is really cool. It's very cinematic, especially the fact that we, you know, just did it the week before.
It's very Star Wars. I just want to drop you in someplace.
Yeah.
And there's talking otters. I mean, who the fuck doesn't like talking otters?
How can you not be behind otters on ostriches? And then so... Again, you know, it was kind of like the only point, you know, we had tons of points we wanted to make about atheism. We had tons of arguments with Dawkins' book. We had tons of things we wanted to say. But when you're doing a show like this, it's like you got to just kind of hone it down to sort of one idea. And, the one idea was just basically like the one thing that Dawkins had basically asserted in his book was if we got rid of religion, the world would be peaceful and there'd be no war and there'd be no...
Not as much war.
And it's just ridiculous because it's like, you know...
Our whole point is people are going to fight no matter what.
And especially for an evolutionist to think that, because an evolutionist of anyone should realize that that's how life works, is it wars upon itself in one way or another. It eats itself, it fights itself, and that's how biology works, you know. And so it was really just sort of that assertion that we wanted to rip on. And also the assertion that basically some of the super intelligent scientist people can be really retarded when it comes to just sort of common sense.
Yeah.
And that's why Dawkins ends up, you know, having sex with Garrison, not having no idea that it's actually he was a man.
Right.
Because he can be so smart, Richard Dawkins, but so dumb. It's like
so dumb in the way he presents himself. You're like, dude, don't you realize that's only going to make people mad and not that's get what, any support?
His big assertion and Sam Harris's big assertion is that atheists are marginalized in America, that like an atheist can't get elected public office. And you're like, well, the only people, if you mention atheism to most Americans, they think about the guy who wanted under God out of the Declaration the Pledge of Allegiance, and Richard Dawkins and Sam Harris, who are both bitchy whiners. And you're like, well, no wonder you guys can't get elected.
Right.
You know, you got to think about...
Have some common sense.
Yeah, politics isn't about truth. It's about, you know, presenting some big smiley face guy. That, you know? So,
but I really love in this... I remember we pretty quickly wrote the phone call section where Cartman calls back and is trying to get people to not let him freeze himself. I think that stuff's really funny. But also the animation, if you look in the background, there's just always tons of stuff going on. And the look of this whole show is pretty amazing. The animators did an amazing job in a week. I mean,
it is. It's unbelievable. Let's move on.
Yeah. That's good.
It may be the future for you, but I can't hook up anything to a float screen without at least a laser 7 output.